I'm here with Jenny Toomey, who's the International Director of Technology and Society for the Ford Foundation. And she is responsible for a lot of the funding we have today in public interest technology. So I'd love you to talk about what you and what Ford is trying to do with public interest tech.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was enlightened self-interest originally, because we've been working on internet freedom issues, and our grantees largely were policy experts or lawyers, but they weren't technologists, and the field was desperate for technologists. But when we found technologists, they didn't necessarily always have the skills that made them great partners in the policy or the technology environment. And so we realized that we actually had to invest in some of the pipelines to ensure that students got trained to be able to have these different skills, and that governments and NGOs knew how to recruit and hire and retain them, and that these folks could actually feel like there was a pathway to have a great career in the space. And so we've just been investing in a bunch of experiments to try to see if we could do something we did back in the 70s and late 60s as a foundation, which was invest in the institutions that built up the field of public interest law. So we're hoping that these kinds of investments will end up with a moment where a technologist can get a computer science degree or an engineering degree and come out and say, I want to go into a private company, or I want to go into government, or I want to go work at this cool NGO. And all of that would seem reasonable.
So this is a long-term strategy of Ford. This is not just one thing you do in this year. This is sort of your vision for the future of society and the future of rights and sort of what we want our society to be.
Absolutely. Technology is touching every aspect of every part of the world that we're living in. And right now, we have a challenge because the technology sector understands what's happening with technology, but government usually doesn't, and NGOs certainly don't. And so we have this environment where there's a really dangerous imbalance of power. Because the historic sort of checks and balances on what technology can do aren't being checked and balanced, because the checkers and the balancers don't actually have tech experts who are helping them think through exactly what this change is going to mean.
So there's a lot of pieces to this, mm-hmm. and you commissioned a report by Friedman Consulting some years ago that outlined three broad areas: supply, demand, marketplace, and like 20-something different types of interventions. And so what are you doing to try to move all of this? Is it little investing here and there? Is it finding a few things that work really well? I love the parallel of public interest law. I use it all the time. But so what is it going to take to really jumpstart this ecosystem?
Well, that first report, A Future of Failure, makes the argument that it's inevitable that we're going to have technologists everywhere. The question is rather going to be, do we have the right kinds of technologists and do we get them quickly enough? And so we did. We identified not just like the 26 or whatever you said, there was probably like 100 different places where the kind of technologist you'd need at a social justice organization would fall out of the pipeline from elementary school all the way through to, you know, their career. And we couldn't do all of that. We made smaller buckets and we've picked a couple. What I'm noticing is the little bit of work we're doing is actually attracting many, many other partners. I mean, we were so lucky to have someone like Bruce come out and be such an incredibly strong advocate from a completely different perspective than what we were working in, like philanthropy or NGOs. So I think the things that we're most invested in at this moment right now is working with the universities to get out of their own way. You know, they have the computer science schools and they have the humanities departments. They're just not necessarily figuring out ways to create integrated curriculums that allow students to realize there's this other pathway. We're also piloting the use of technologists in a whole bunch of other areas. So we've got, I think at this point, it's almost like a dozen different Tech Fellows programs that put Tech Fellows into Congress, into NGOs, into governments, into our own institutions. And as we have successes there, we're attracting all sorts of support and attention from other foundations, as well as from the fields that we're trying to support with these technologists.
So you're here at the RSA conference, right? This is the conference in computer security. There are 40,000 people here.
Yes, there are.
If even, you know, 1 in 1,000 hear the call, that's 400 people. My guess is we don't have 400 places for them to go.
I wouldn't be so sure. It depends on, I mean, these are pretty elevated technologists, and I think you may be right. There may not be an obvious 400 places for them to go in 2019, mm-hmm. but I think that's going to change, and it's going to change pretty rapidly. I think the tech companies have realized that by not integrating these kinds of other skills in their teams that are working on product design, they're actually creating blind spots that are coming back and biting them at other moments. And I think governments and NGOs are realizing that technology has far outpaced understanding and, I don't want to say just constraint, but the kinds of natural protections that allow innovation to be integrated into our rule of law, into our rights frameworks and norms. And so I think in the next couple of years, there's going to be no end to the number of places where people from this world can find a new spot for themselves. But right now, we have to do that work. We have to do that work. And it's so exciting because we've brought this incredible group of superstars who managed to do it largely on their own with sort of bubblegum and duct tape. And so having them tell their stories as well as showing the incredible opportunity, hopefully we'll be making that argument that you want to come over to the public interest technology side.
And that's right. I think the goal is to make this scale, mm-hmm. that it's not just going to be a few people, it has to be a lot of people in all areas of policy, in all areas of tech. And then one of the things you do is that when you fund a rights organization, you fund a technologist sometimes for them, for that organization, that you make them think about the tech implications of what they're doing as a rights organization, as a non-tech organization.
So we do it lots of different ways. We want technology organizations with a social justice orientation. We want them in coalition with historic rights organizations that may not have technologists, and it's really awesome when you can actually get a technologist to be so important to a rights organization that they actually, you know, take that valuable space and they hire someone and put that person in one of the very few seats that most NGOs can afford to pay for. So it's going to be everything across all of those spectrums.
So one of the things I'm often asked from people in my industry who have money, who've made money, who want to fund this and they don't know how, is there any advice you can give them of places they can put their money? Either, are there umbrella organizations? Are there, you know, lists of organizations who need help in this space? It's always hard to figure out how to give well when you don't know the space.
So I think there's two things I would say about that. One, you know, watch this space, because there's a bunch of those kinds of tools that are being researched and documented right at this moment. And so 6 months from now, there's going to be more, I don't know if it's going to be plug and play, but there's going to be more opportunities to actually put resources towards this. That said, there are old-fashioned ways to do this, which is if you've been a great supporter of the ACLU, or if you've been a great supporter of another NGO that you really believe in their work, you might reach out to the leadership and ask them how they are factoring in the technological change, and you might ask whether you could contribute resources to helping them bring more technical capacity into that organization. Or if you fund universities, a lot of people, that's a very safe way for people to fund. There'll be announcements in the next couple weeks that a number of universities, state schools, as well as some of the most elite universities, are pledging to change how they do their education. And a great way to support this would be, instead of supporting that library, that, you know, the Bruce Schneier Library or whatever it would be, you could actually put resources into your universities to actually build these new intersectionalist ways of training technologists. So those are two obvious things you can do right now based on how you're already spending your money. And hopefully, if we do this work correctly, there's going to be a bunch of funds and a bunch of different ways you can do it in a one-stop shop kind of way.
It's great to see Forge leadership in this. And I thank you for the work you're doing, and I hope it continues.
Well, and the fact that we would attract someone who's as respected and wonderful as you to be a champion says that we're doing the right thing.
And I think we are.
Great.